I'm Alan Hall, President and CEO of WeatherGuard Lightning Tech, and in this tutorial, I'm going to discuss EASA requirements for lightning protection CS25581. Let's get started. So there are really three things to remember here with the regulations, because it's broken up in three parts. The first part of CS25581 is part A, which is the airplane must be protected against catastrophic effects from lightning. So also see CS25899, which is a bonding requirement. So the first criteria is you must stop catastrophic effects. Pretty straightforward. And in this image, there's an aircraft that has clearly crashed into the runway. That was due to a lightning strike from several years ago, where lightning struck the control surfaces in the back end of the airplane in the empennage. Caused some damage back there, and it severely degraded the pilot's ability to land the airplane safely. So we don't have a lot of catastrophic incidences with aircraft and lightning strikes today, but they occasionally do have very severe accidents, hazardous type events where lightning has damaged the aircraft and we lose some capability of the aircraft. In this particular case, they are fortunate enough to put it on the runway. But now, let's get to part B. Part B, metallic components. So part B is discussing metallic components specifically. For metallic components, compliance with subparagraph A of this paragraph may be shown by 1, bonding the components properly to the airframe, or 2, designing the components so that a strike will not endanger the airplane. So there's two images here. On the left is a King Air wingtip, which is a metallic wingtip, where lightning has attached to that wingtip and physically warped, crushed part of the aircraft structure, right? So electrical bonding does play into that. You want to give the lightning current someplace to go, right? But even then, there's still structural effects that can happen on aluminum airplanes. And just to the right of that is a image or a typical lightning attachment location where it melts a rivet head or melts a small port of the metallic surface of the aircraft. Okay, so those are two sort of extreme examples of a typical lightning attachment and a severe lightning attachment. So let's go to non-metallic component, which is covered in part C. For non-metallic components, compliance with subparagraph A of this paragraph may be shown by 1, designing the components to minimize the effect of a strike, or 2, incorporating acceptable means of diverting the resulting electrical current so as not to endanger the airplane. So I provide two pictures here. For part one, we're showing a composite wingtip made out of carbon fiber that has expanded metal foil on it. So they've designed the component with expanded metal foil to minimize the effect of the strike to prevent maximum damage to the composite structure. So the metal foils are carrying some of the lightning energy away from the composite surface. So that's a way to minimize the effect of a strike. The other one, part two, which just shows up it's an Airbus radome, which has a copper bar on the radome. That's a means of diverting electrical current. So the copper bars provide a pathway for lightning to travel away from the non-conductive fiberglass Kevlar nose of the Airbus airplane. All right, so those show you two different examples there. So diverting the current or incorporating acceptable means to carry the current. All right, so that's the regulation. Now, there's a number of pieces of guidance material that you will need to acquire to help you through the certification effort for 25581. Let's take a look at those. There are 4 documents, and those 4 documents from EuroK and SAE has equivalent documents, but you can find the EuroK ones online. ED113, Aircraft Lightning Direct Effect Certification, ED91A, Lightning Zoning, ED84A, Aircraft Lightning Environment and Related Test Waveforms, and then ED105A, Aircraft Lightning Test Methods. So each one of those has a specific piece of information you're going to need for compliance for CS25581. So you need to gather the whole group there. So what is the process to show compliance to 25581? Well, it's outlined in ED113. And I've broken it down into 5 steps to sort of simplify it a little bit, because this is the process that I usually follow. Otherwise, you can get super complicated in detail and very specific steps, but in general, this is the process to follow. Step one, determine the lightning strike zones for the aircraft. Step two, establish the lightning environment. Step three, perform a lightning hazard assessment. Step four, design the protection. And step five, verify compliance. So let's walk through each one of those in detail so you can see how each one of those little steps gets performed. So step one, lightning strike zones. ED-91A is going to contain that information. And it's going to discuss each of the different lightning zones that apply to particular parts of the aircraft and different types of aircraft. So it explains lightning zones for rotorcraft, helicopters, for jet aircraft where the engines are mounted on the fuselage, or jet aircraft where the engines are mounted on the wing, and basically different sizes of aircraft and different configurations. They also include turboprops in that discussion, but we need to define where lightning is likely to attach, because it has specific implications for the amount of damage that you're likely to see on that particular component. So in general, there are three zones. Zone one, which tends to be the extremities, the wingtips, the tail tips, the nose. Zone two, and that has a maximum current applied of 200,000 amps. Lightning zone two, which tends to be the fuselage of most aircraft, some parts of the wing, some parts of the tail, but sort of the middle of the aircraft. That has a maximum current of 100,000 amps. And then zone three is everywhere else, which tends to be on most aircraft in the middle of the wing. Right, so just to get a sense of what the lightning zones are, I provided an example here, but you need to go look in ED-91A for the specifics. Step two is looking at the lightning environment. The lightning environment is defined in ED-105A. And so it takes those zones on one, zone two, zone three, and applies lightning energy to them to evaluate damage. So just as a rule of thumb here, lightning zone one is a 200,000 amp strike with current components A, B, and C. And there's voltage effects that go along with it, but we're going to simplify it here and just talk about the high current part of it, the damage part of it. Lightning zone two, which is 100,000 amps, which is components D, B, and C, if you look in the spec. And then lightning zone three, which is a 40 kiloamp strike, which is components A or 5, B, and C. So just in general, just so you know, so the wingtips and the nose and the tail extremities need to be designed to handle 200,000 amp strikes. The main body of most aircraft, the fuselages, need to be designed to handle 100,000 amps in lightning zone 2, and then those odd things that are on lightning zone 3 need to be able to handle 40,000 amps. Okay, so that's step 2. Now, moving on to step 3. The lightning hazard assessment. So we need to evaluate the likely lightning damage for aircraft structures, but also systems. And when I say systems, I'm not talking about avionics displays, but more importantly, like control tubes, control rods, things that are mechanical in nature that are located typically out towards extremities, flap actuators, things of that sort, in which if lightning struck near them or lightning attached to the flap or an aileron, there could be subsequent effects inside the airplane. There wouldn't be a direct strike sort of situation, but the effects of carrying large amounts of current could do damage and affect the aircraft performance, right? So we're looking for catastrophic effects, a failure or a malfunction, and that can happen immediately, like if you severed a control cable, or it could have some other delay. It could be a delayed effect. So if you were to damage a composite structure, but to continue the flight, you overloaded that structure because it's been weakened from the lightning strike, that would be a delayed effect, and you still have to consider that. So as you're going through that evaluation, you need to really determine what primary structure is for the aircraft, because those are the ones you really need to pay attention to. Because primary structure, if you damage primary structure, you're essentially going to lose the aircraft. So 25571 from the FAA side, if you want to go look there, there's a similar EASA requirement for primary structure, and then AC 25571, which is the FAA requirement. There's also guidance from EASA too to look at primary structure and what that is. For most lightning engineers, we electrical people, we don't really know what primary structure is. My advice is to talk to the structures groups at the aircraft companies that you're working with to determine what is primary structure, to understand what those primary structures are so that you're working on the right thing and focusing your energies and time on the right parts of the aircraft. Continuing with the lightning hazard assessment, we're going to look at structural components. That includes fasteners and major structural joints, control surfaces, pushrods, cables, actuators, hinges, bond jumpers, externally mounted components like antennas and radomes. We're also going to look at loss of system function, like in, you lose the effect of aircraft power, for example. So you take a strike to the structure and you're near a big power cable and it damages the power cable, that's a subsequent effect, but you need to be looking at that as an effect on the aircraft that is due from a lightning direct effects strike. So even though the regulation is really focused on structures, you need to also be looking on the effects of systems so you don't have a subsequent effect which then endangers the aircraft, right? And then in particular, I think a good place to sort of help you put all this together and provide a thought process on how to evaluate it is in AMC, which is an acceptable means of compliance, 25.1309. So in there, you can use it to create basically a 1309 type assessment, but we're going to consider it a life safety classification. It's not a probabilistic assessment. It's a qualitative assessment. But we need to look at those pieces of hardware and components on the aircraft that could be affected by a direct strike and determine whether the direct strike can affect aircraft safety. Okay, moving on to step four, design protection for metallic components. Okay, so we're looking at typical materials, aluminum, steel, titanium, things that are used typically in aircraft. We want to look at cross sections, thicknesses, how they're attached. Is it bolted? Is it welded? Is it riveted? Is there some adhesives? We want to look at coatings, from anodized coatings, which are non-conductive, to allodyne coatings, which are conductive, to different kinds of paints and surface protectants. And then we want to look at electrical bonding, right? So we're trying to make sure that when we design some piece of metal to carry lightning currents, that it has an adequate cross section, that it's connected together, and the joints will be able to carry lightning current without coming apart. So when we design non-metallic components, right? So when we're designing protection for things like fiberglass or Kevlar or carbon fiber, we need to go look at specifically what those materials are. So a carbon fiber piece of structure will have slightly different types of protection than a piece of fiberglass will. Again, we're going to look at the thickness and the cross section. We're going to look at things like metal foils, conductive coatings. Typical things here are copper, bronze, aluminum, or in terms of expanded metal foils, and then silver, which is a very common conductive sprayed material that is applied to fiberglass and to carbon fiber. So we want to try to determine how we want to protect it. There's a lot of choices out there. You need to really look up the literature, do some research, ask around, call us to get an idea of what are likely paths, what other companies have done in similar situations, because there's a lot of data out there at this point. So you're not in the blind. You should be able to find some help to guide you on what types of lightning protection are probably appropriate for your application. Strike tape diverters, which is another way, that's our product. Applying lightning diverters to aircraft radomes, very common. It just diverts the lightning current away, protects the structure. And then we also want to look at how we're attaching those non-metallic components to the rest of the airplane. Are they bolted? Are they just screwed on? Are they adhesively bonded? Because we need to provide current paths from the non-metallic structure to the next piece of structure, be it metallic or non-metallic. How are we getting across those joints? And then as part of that, we're going to look at electrical bonding, right? So those are the design details we need to be looking at as we're providing protection. All right, step five. So once you've identified how you're going to protect those parts, be it metallic or non-metallic, how do you go about justifying it, showing the EASA or FAA or any other certification authority how your design actually functions? That is mostly done by lightning tests today. There are some cases where you can do it via analysis if you have previous test data, obviously, or if you have a lot of aircraft service history. In some cases, it can be appropriate, but mostly you're going to get into some sort of lightning test. Analysis is used, and I provide two pieces of information there from the FAA site, but there is a aircraft lightning protection handbook, which is available on the internet. And also there's a Agate lightning direct effects handbook, which has a lot of information about types of lightning damage to carbon fiber and fiberglass structures that are protected with a variety of different kinds of foils and paints and that kind of thing. The last one that doesn't get used as much is similarity. So similarity tends to get used where we have a metallic wingtip on an Airbus A320. We want to go to use that metallic wingtip on an Airbus 319. Okay, so there's similar aircraft. The designs are very similar. Therefore, we can apply the results from one or the certification approach from one design onto the next design. That's where similarity tends to get used in 25581 type processes. Those are the five steps. But EASA provides additional information, which is fantastic, because if you're just trying to design a component for the first time, you'd like to have a little bit of guidance. And the acceptable means of compliance that EASA puts out provides that information. So let's walk through the acceptable means of compliance. This is not a deep thought, thorough experiment, evaluation of the AMC, but just want to highlight that this information is there and how design engineers apply that information. So the AMC 25581, which discusses external metal parts, and external metal parts should be either A, electrically bonded to the main earth system by primary bonding paths, or B, so designed and or protected that a lightning discharge to the part, e.g. a radio aerial, will cause only local damage which will not endanger the airplane or its occupants. Okay, so what does that mean? Well, let's keep going down the AMC and see what that means. So one, bond internal linkages of external parts to the airframe. All right, so what they're trying to do is get lightning currents off linkages, structural paths that are control surface related, so to speak. Screw jacks, or I show a screw jack here where there's been bonding done to that screw jack, or a quadrant, which is the control cables, how it attaches to an aileron or an elevator or a rudder, where there's a bond jumper that tries to dump the currents off of the control surface back to main airframe structure and doesn't allow a lot of current to go down the control line, which could be damaged and create a catastrophic effect. So at the bottom of each one of these slides is the actual words down here. I'm going to try to summarize each one of them just for the sake of time. So the second thing, design bonding jumpers to limit current through actuators, right? So typically what you see, this is on the horizontal stabilizers of jets or turboprop airplanes, where they have horizontal pitch trims. That whole horizontal stabilizer is riding on an actuator, and what they're trying to do is provide a current path that's not through the actuator. Smart thing to do. Okay, so I provide two examples here. This is what you see, these sort of bigger bond jumpers up in the horizontal stabilizers, and there's an example here of from a manual that shows a bond jumper going from the horizontal stabilizer to the scissors structure that carries a current away from the actuator. Pretty standard designs, right? Evaluate all flight configurations and damage to electrical system components. Now, what we're talking about here specifically are things like electric components on the outside of the airplane, like AOA probes that are heated, pedostatic probes or static ports that are heated, anything that's sort of sitting on the outside of the airplane has power running to it, because you want to prevent transient surges and things like that from getting onto the power bus or damaging other things in the electrical system. So when we install a heated pedo probe, we're going to do a lightning test on it to make sure that we do not inject current onto the power bus and damage the displays, for example. All right, so we want to evaluate those all the flight configurations and components on the outside of the aircraft. So the flight configuration can play into a little bit when we have flaps down, there's our components that are exposed that wouldn't normally ordinarily be exposed in certain parts of flight. Deployment of landing gear, right? So there's anti-skid on the landing gear. Those things are normally tucked up in the airplane, but when the airplane's coming in to land or during takeoff, there are situations where those components are sitting out in free space and can be struck by lightning and can inject a bunch of current onto the rest of the aircraft. So things to think about in terms of external metal parts. So external non-metallic parts, you want to provide them with some sort of diverters, right? Be it metal bars, foils, or strike tape lightning diverters. So you want to provide a pathway for lightning to go around non-metallic parts if you can, right? But you also need to make sure that we're designing those things properly. They're handling the amount of current for where they're going to be installed, right? You want to prevent damage that endangers the aircraft. So on non-conductive components, there are times in which the component, based on where it is, really won't endanger the aircraft, right? And so there, I provided an example here. This, I think, is a C-130 or a military aircraft, U.S. military aircraft, where the little fairing at the back of the horizontal stabilizer has been knocked off. Well, that doesn't have an effect on safety, right? That part can come off, come clean off, and nobody really cares in terms of safety, right? So, but if there are places where lightning may endanger the airplane, we need to make sure that we are taking care of them and making sure we identify them first and design protection for them. And then for radomes in particular, so there's a lot of discussions about radomes in the AMC. We want to ensure that lightning hits the diverters and the diverters are sized properly, right? So on a nose radome, we want to make sure that we actually have, if we're using copper bars, we have appropriate cross sections to carry the current. You can do it by sort of analysis to get you a rough estimate of that, or just look at what other aircraft companies have done, and make sure that those parts, those diverters, are in the right places on those parts on the radomes, and that usually that follows up with a lightning test, right, to validate all that. So there's a bunch of other things here in sort of the non-metallic parts for EASA where they want to look at and discuss particular aspects to those non-conductive parts. So I'm going to read through these real quickly. So where unprotected non-metallic parts are fitted externally to the airplane in situations when they may be exposed to lightning discharges, e.g. radomes, the risks include the following. And so I provide an example of pretty much all these risks here with a big lightning hole in a nose radome. A, the disruption of the materials because of rapid expansion of gases within them, e.g. water vapor. So water vapor inside of a radome honeycomb structure, radomes tend to be fiberglass, honeycomb structure, fiberglass. If you get water inside of there, that in theory, that water could heat up and create more damage, right? B, the rapid buildup of pressure in the enclosures provided by the parts, resulting in mechanical disruption of the parts themselves or the structure enclosed by them. So what they're saying is if you have an enclosure like a radome and you happen to puncture it, there is pressure built up inside of there from the lightning strike, and that part can come apart and do damage to itself, obviously, or to things that are around it. C, fire caused by ignition of the materials themselves or the materials contained within the enclosure. So if lightning happens to puncture the radome, does it catch the radome on fire? Does it make the antenna or catch the antenna on fire inside? Things you need to evaluate, right? So it's very important if you're going to allow a puncture to a radome that you look at subsequent effects, right? And D, holes in the non-metallic part which may present a hazard at high speeds. So this is why I provided the picture here, which is a high-speed aircraft where there's been a large hole in the radome. You need to also look at aerodynamic effects, that do you overpressurize the radome to affect where it starts to come apart from the aero loads, right? So things to think about it for non-metallic parts. All right, so also on non-metallic parts, and EASA is very thorough about this. Let's walk through 2.3, 2.4, and 2.5, which is the materials used should not absorb water and should be of high dielectric strength in order to encourage surface flashover rather than puncture. Laminates made entirely from solid materials are preferable to those incorporating laminations of cellular material. And cellular material means honeycomb, essentially what that means. So if you build a solid piece of laminate, it doesn't want to absorb water, which makes it a little more resilient in lightning strike, less likely to be punctured. So the preference is to make solid structures versus honeycomb structures from a lightning protection standpoint. Even though both designs are flying today very successfully, you just need to make sure that you're trying to prevent water from accumulating in honeycomb structures. That's essentially what it means. 2.4. Those external non-metallic parts which is not classified as primary structure should be protected by primary conductors, right? So what they're saying here is that if I have a secondary structure, so a secondary structure tends to be fairings, covers, things of that sort, that we design them such that we provide primary current paths on them, right? We don't forget about them. Doesn't mean you can't damage them or they can't be damaged by lightning, because they will be, but we don't just discard them and say, oh, it's, you know, it's completely necessarily sacrificial. We're going to provide some means of carrying the current, ideally. So this is a way of complying with the regulation. There are different takes on this, and this one can be kind of controversial, quite honestly, right? But the thought process is like, hey, we need to do something here in terms of lightning protection. And 2.5, where damage to an external non-metallic part which is not classified as primary structure may endanger the airplane, the part should be protected by adequate lightning diverters. Okay, let's give an example of that. If I have a large SATCOM radome on top of the fuselage and a lightning strike punctures that and damages that radome comes loose and hits the vertical tail structure, that could be catastrophic. So the radome itself is not primary structure, but the subsequent effects from that lightning strike could cause damage to the aircraft, which it would allow it not allow it to continue safe flight and landing. That needs to be fixed. And they're saying you need to put lightning diverters to prevent that from happening. Just makes sense. It just follows the logic of the regulation. Okay, 2.6, confirmatory tests may be required to check the adequacy of the lightning protection provided, e.g. to confirm the adequacy of the location and size of bonding strips on a large radome. And I provided a picture here of a high voltage lightning attachment test. So what they're saying here is that if you have essentially a new design or an unproven design, which is where this is going, is that you want to perform some sort of lightning test on it per the guidance materials to validate it. And you make sure you have, one, that the design actually works like intended, and two, it can handle the amount of current that it's likely to experience in flight. Smart thing to do. It happens all the time. There are a number of lightning test facilities all around the world which can provide this level of testing. So it should be readily easy to do. And I think the key is here is to get some advice before you get to the point of going to the lightning lab. You should be fairly confident in your design, either by looking at other aircraft, talking to the lightning protection engineers, or pulling relevant data to protect the radome before you actually get to the lightning lab. So that does it for our tutorial on EASA's CS25581. If you have lightning protection questions, check out our YouTube channel with a bunch of informational videos, or visit our website at weatherguardaero.com.